Hi everyone, this is Kelly from The Truth and Story, and today we're going to be looking at the Thoth or the Thoth Tarot, however you prefer it to be pronounced. I really was starting to get paralyzed at doing this, and I finally said to myself, Kelly, it's okay, this is just step one. I don't have to explain the entire Thoth Tarot in one video. I really want this to be basically a walkthrough video. And I was getting I've done so much reading in the last couple days that I was starting to get like, how can I get all this information across? Because it's so completely awesome. But that's not really possible. So I'm going to focus today, for the most part, on just doing a walkthrough of the cards and a sample reading and that kind of thing. But I do want to say, I've been putting malachite with this. I actually, Alex, who gave me this deck as well as these books here, gifted with me this beautiful piece of malachite. But I don't really want to put this big one with the deck because I want to be able to hold it and stuff. So I have another piece of malachite that Miss Stone gave me. And it looks like the shape of a foot. And it's like the journey of a thousand steps begin with one step. I'm saying that incorrectly, but I don't want to stop and look it up. But I thought it was perfectly, because I'm starting out on this journey to learn Thoth, and so I thought that was beautiful. So that's kind of what's been staying with my deck. I'm just dying to read with it, so I have got to get it off of out of being in order. So I'm going to get to this in just a second, but before I do that, I do want to talk just a little bit about books, because let's face it, I think we all are of the understanding that if you're going to start on the journey with the Thoth Tarot, that there is going to be some study involved to get the most out of it. And so when Alex gave me this beautiful deck, now this was, let me make one quick note here because people have already asked. This deck, I checked with Alex, and he said that this was the large Thoth deck, which is in the green box. And it is, you know, they are about the size of an Oracle card when they are not trimmed down. And then he trimmed off the borders, and then he added this gold edging to the sides and, you know, all around here on both sides. So that was added on, but this was trimmed fully. And then I have added the numbers for the majors, and then for the minors I have down in this corner like I did with my Marielle. So that's what I have, although truthfully I guess in some of the minors you really wouldn't have to do that, but I just opted for that. So that's what this is, the large green box from US Game Systems, trimmed down. There's that. I wanted to make sure I pointed that out. Now, I'll get to this one in a second, but these were the books that he gave me with it. This is the Book of Thoth, which is by Aleister Crowley himself. So this is the original text that he, I don't know what I have marked here. Oh, I think that's, I'm going to use that as an example. So this is the original text. It goes through all the cards, plus a lot of information. And so I'm, you know, obviously it's always good to go to the source, to start with the source. The other one that he gave me is this by Linda I.H. Hughes, The 22 Keys of Wisdom, which is a study of the major arcana. So then this is going through and doing really detailed study with these large images of each of the major arcana. And then last, Ali, he gave me Keywords for the Crowley Tarot by Hajo Banshoff, I'm sure I'm slaughtering that, and Brigitte Theller. He is apparently, Quilfin told me, he is a German author and he has some other books on tarot. I quite like this book. Now, you know, somebody pointed out you really shouldn't learn off of keywords. Thoth isn't about keywords. I completely agree with that, but that's why I have, you know, another book of the actual text and the text I got. But in terms of just, I love where it goes piece by piece of each of the little individual aspects of the card and gives you an idea what it is. I also like it split into different kinds of ways to reading it, and then it has it for a card of the day and a card of the year for the majors, and for the minors it has it. This is just being used as a place card. For the minors it has just the card of the day. I really like this book. Again, it's, you know, I wouldn't recommend getting the Sparks notes for reading Moby Dick, but just to have, just to kind of condense everything down, I'm really liking this book, and I really like the intro, which I'll talk about in a second. And I love how these tabs on the side let you know what suit you're looking at and or the majors. I think all books should have that on there. Love that. So that those are the three books that he gave me with it. Now, the other book that I picked up on, look at, there's Katie, and there is Miss Isabel. Katie was over, and she took that picture, and so the next time I came onto my iPad, I saw that, which is adorable. The other one that I had read a lot about was Understanding Aleister Crowley's Thoth Tarot by Lon Milo Duquette. I'm assuming that's how it's pronounced. And I went ahead and got this because I had read that this was a really good book for getting to know the basics behind, let's say, the Tree of Life, the Rose Cross that is on the back. It has a whole chapter about that was absolutely fascinating. Let's just look at that just for an example here. The Secrets of the Rose Cross Back. But what I really want to show you more than this is this figure here. Look at, can I zoom it? Yeah. Look at this. We have, you know, so air is yellow, fire is red, water is blue, and earth is this mix of colors here. We have here each of these representing the court cards and the aces on this pentacle, because each, you know, knight is a element as well. Each king is an element, or I'm sorry, knight. We'll go over that in a minute because it changes. But the court cards and their elements within the elements are there, as well as the alchemical. So these are the alchemical for mercury, sulfur, and salt. And depending on which one is primary in that suit, it has it in the top thing here. Oops, I don't want that. There we go. I guess I'm going to have that. It's too bad. Anyways, then in here we start to get the actual, it's just crazy. It's crazy. We have all of the Tree of Life things, but then they relate to cards. And then we have more stuff down here that relates to things. And YouTube, somebody's saying something. Loving my Lenormand decks for my latest Lenormand March. But this cross has got a ton of information in it. It's fascinating. I spent some time last night, very late, reading about this. Oops, I got to get back here. And so there's a whole chapter about this and explaining Kabbalah, explaining each of the sections of the cross. You know, this is a square that has been opened up, a three-dimensional square that has been opened up. You could fold that back into a box. Yeah, it's just, and it kind of builds it as it goes along and really gets into the trumps, that gets into the petals of this and that. And I mean, it's just insane how much information was in this Rose Cross, and that is what is on the back of that. And so it really goes into detail about that. The other thing I really like, I haven't read this entire book yet because I just got it yesterday, but I've read that, as well as the other reason that I really wanted it was for the Secrets of the Tree of Life. And I have to say that this chapter has been very helpful, because, you know, not just in Thoth, but in tarot in general, the Rider-Waite-Smith is based off of the teachings of the Golden Dawn, which very much put the Kabbalah and the Tree of Life and things together with tarot. That's, you know, that's a very Golden Dawn pairing. So all tarot decks have some associations there. And so it's important, you know, it's helpful to know that it's not necessary, but it's very helpful. And so I've read through this. I'll have to obviously read through this more than once, but it was extremely helpful in understanding. I really liked also this going through the rules of thumb for numerology. And it talks about how unless there are strong astrological mitigating factors, then these things are so. I've bookmarked that because that's a whole nother video. I mean, I'm so excited about this deck. It does my kind of researching kind of heart, going crazy over all the information that I want to get to. But today is just going to be about, you know, kind of giving you an idea what I'm doing reading book-wise to do with it, as well as, you know, a look at it. Obviously, I think it's good to have the source book. That's always a good thing. That other book by Ducat, I also, from what I've read, is, you know, a really highly recommended book also about it to really get into things. And I have certainly, with just the little that I have looked at it so far, I would have to agree with that. I read quite a few chapters of it. But what I will say, I have read pretty much all of this book. I haven't gone through every single wordage on it, but I have gone through almost all the cards, you know, kind of getting a basic feel for it. And I have read the introduction. There are some spreads that I am really interested in looking at. I really like this particular one because I do an astrological tarot reading with birth charts. But what they did was actually also go a step further, and they do it pretty much how I do it with the houses, but then they go along the axis to connect things even more so with these triads and things. That's quite interesting, so I'm definitely going to play around with that. In fact, I have a couple to do, and I will be using those connections, which I kind of do anyways, but not methodically, and so I quite like seeing that. I also... Again, the numbers, so important, especially in a deck in which, you know, it's a technically pip cards. This door, I'm very, very much interested in doing. In fact, I'll probably do this tonight after I can finally shuffle my deck. So there was just some, there's a lot in the spread section that I thought was very interesting. And they do talk, I love this as well. Now, this is interesting because, and I know I'm kind of all over the place, there's so much information that I was kind of stopping me from even doing a review or anything, or a walkthrough, because there's just so much information, and I've read so much in a little, so little of a time that it's kind of like, blah! I'm like, Kelly, you can do multiple videos on the Thoth Tarot. But I did like this particular in this book, which was the Quintessence. Now, I do this for playing card readings. I do this for Lenormand, but I don't very often, very rarely, do this for tarot, and I should more, because this is where you condense everything down, the numbers, add all the numbers, and bring it down into, you know, the basic numbers that you have in numerology, and then getting an overall energy based off of that. I don't know why I don't do that with tarot, because I, again, do this for other divination systems. So that was definitely a reminder to that. They do talk about reverse cards being both approaches are correct and simply depend, like so many things in tarot, on the rules of the game that the interpreter uses. And that's what I really liked about this particular, and I'm so sorry, Alex, but I hope this, you don't cringe when you see this, although there was underwriting it, lining in this, these books, but I am definitely an underliner and a scribbler. But I really liked the approach. So definitely moved into some Jungian ideas for certain. I could really do a whole video just on this particular book, like doing a book review on this. But Tarot can symbolize a dialogue between the conscious and the unconscious mind, obviously. People who comprehend these messages and who allow themselves to be guided by them will take their very own path, one that corresponds with their individuality, and they will find themselves as a result. It goes into a good discussion about the three paths of... you know, we have the traditional cards, or like the Marseille cards, the Waite Tarot, and then the Crowley Tarot. We show the differences, where which is an important difference in the court cards. The courts use knight, queen, prince, and princess, which I quite love. I love the page being princess because I see that anyways, but as sort of a feminine energy. I love the king, the explanation as to why, and we'll get into that later, but that why it's not as a king but as a knight on a horse. So the princes, I think, are generally in chariots, and the knights, which are the highest level in the court, would be on horses. It does talk about how Crowley places himself between the simple but shallow depiction of the old cards, like the Marseille, and the easily understandable motifs of the Waite Tarot. We could say that he abstracted the respective idea in his cards. As a result, their meaning is expressed quite well, but only for those who are capable of reading the symbols. So it goes in and talks about all kinds of things. I did really like this. It talks about, you know, is there a right and wrong tarot? And this book really, the introductionary areas, really goes into that understanding that it is a language, and that it's all about the interpreter being more as someone who is interpreting dreams, the language of dreams, somebody that knows the language more than the person that they're reading for. And so they're simply reading that in a beautiful way. So it talks about the decisive factor is not which tarot is used or whether an answer is obtained from the reading, the runes, the I Ching, or coffee grounds. What matters is how well versed the reader is in the language of the respective oracle, or how well the asker understands the message that has been laid by coincidence in the corresponding arrangements. It does also talk about it being very important when someone designs a tarot deck that only has a choice of dark themes, the answer will inevitably be one-sided, and the same applies to tarot deck that consists solely of harmlessly sweet motifs. So that's also, I love that that was put in here. There's just so much. This, I'm going to have to, obviously, the quality of the interpretation is naturally dependent upon the interpreter's inner horizon. I thought this was quite interesting. So she kind of goes at it, or he and she kind of go at it from questions such as, is there a secret, but really true, final, and objective meaning for the cards? No, it's all subjective. A symbol can never be understood to mean just one thing or comprehended in all its depth. In this respect, even very different interpretations can be correct, since each of them respectively illuminates another aspect of the whole. Just fantastic. I mean, I think that the card reader is not a fortune teller, but a translator who speaks the language of images. That was quite interesting. Although it does talk about future casting and that type of thing. 3 to 6 months, which is generally my time period of questions. I just really resonated with this beginning section here, written in this particular book, a lot. And I will probably be looking for other books by them as well. So that's that. I think this is great just to get you in there. And again, you know, what is the muddy poison lake? That's a symbol of this. It could be. And these, they say at the very, you know, in the beginning, this is just a tip of an iceberg of what these particular symbols might represent. That's just the tip of the iceberg. It's up to you to develop these meanings further, but it just gets you started, a place for you to roll off from. So, loving this, clearly, and because we are now 20 minutes in and we haven't even looked at the cards. Okay, so we talked a little bit about the backings, so I'm not going to go any further into that, although, again, there's a whole study on rose crosses within the Golden Dawn, and it's amazing. So there we have that. Of course, you know, this is only as good as what I have. You know, this is obviously a cut version of the card. Let me see. Okay, here, now these are not in color, but you can see what a card would have looked like. So they have a white border around it. The miners have the number and what a shaded, you can't really see it very well, of the suit, and then a keyword at the bottom. The majors have the Roman numeral at the top. It has the title of the card. It has the Kabbalah, corresponding Kabbalah, as well as elemental associations and or astrological associations, which I will probably go and add back into the majors on mine, although I have not done that as yet. I might do that before I go and shuffle them. Now, I do not have the little white book for this, but I have heard from researching that I have done that it's a pretty decent one to give you at least some basic information on it. I don't personally think that any little white book is going to do the Thoth Tarot justice, or truthfully, the Rider-Waite-Smith either. If this is a new system to you, I think this is simply one of those things that you are going to have to invest in a book or two or three or four just to get, you know, to really. Now, again, you can, you know, people read completely intuitively, but there's so much going on that then is going to be missed. So I thought I would give you a couple examples here. So this is the Fool card. And I have the Fool card is the longest section in the Book of Thoth by Crowley. I want, oh, here we go. Here's some color images with the, so you can see how it says Trumps in shadow and then the actual Trump name there. And then for the Ace of Swords, whoops. It has, in kind of in shadow, it has a sword suit and then what it is there. So that's kind of how those are set up. So there's some color versions with the border intact. So, but this is like 22 pages just on the Fool card. So there's a lot there, and I'm not going to go into all of that because that's, you know, for you to study. But I do want to give you an example of, because he does near the end, because, you know, people will say, well, he didn't read this, he didn't put these in for divination or really get into keywords or anything like that, which is true. But he does near the ends of his things go into some of those details so that you can follow it. So it says that the design of the present card resumes the principal ideas of the above essay, which was, you know, 22 pages long or 20 pages long. The Fool is the gold of air. So the yellow in most new color, working with colors, yellow is the color for air, red is for wands, blue is for water, and a greedy with black mixed in, and this particular deck has to do with earth. So it is the goldish color in the background of air. He has the horns of Dionysus Zagreus, and he goes into all of these mythologies in the book. And between them is the phallic cone of the white light representing the influence from the crown upon him. He is shown against the background of air, dawning from space, and his attitude is one of bursting unexpectedly upon the world. He is clad in green according to the tradition of spring, but his shoes are the phallic gold of the sun. In his right hand he bears the wand tipped with the pyramid of white of the All-Father. In his left hand he bears the flaming pineapple of similar significance, but more definitely indicating vegetable growth. From his left shoulder hangs a bunch of purple grapes. Grapes represent fertility, sweetness, and the basis of ecstasy. This ecstasy is shown by the stem of the grapes developing into rainbow-hued spirals that you can see going all around him. That's emanating from the stem of the grapes and the ecstasy. And this is the form of the universe with the swirling here. It suggests a threefold veil of the negative manifesting by his intervention in divided light. Upon the spiral swirl are other attributions of Godhead, the vulture of Maat, the dove of Venus, Isis, or Mary, and the ivy sacred to his devotees. There's also a butterfly of many-colored air and the winged globe with its twin serpents. Winged globe with his twin serpents. trying to find that particular. There's so much going on that you really have to look sometimes. A symbol which is echoed and fortified by the twin infants embracing on the middle spiral. Above them hangs the benediction of three flowers in one. Fawning upon him is a tiger, and beneath his feet in the Nile with its lotus stems crouches the crocodile, resuming all his many forms and many colored images in the center of the figure. The focus of the microcosm is the radiant sun. The whole picture is a glyph of the creative light. So that is just a two or three paragraphs out of the fool, I'm being exaggeratory. So the fool starts at 53, 63, so more like 15-ish or so pages on the fool. So that's a lot of information in the Book of Thoth. So then for an example, just so you get the idea, I just want you to kind of get an idea on these different books. This breaks it down into specifics. So green clothing, meaning such and such, the horns and the crystal, the soles of the boots pointing upward for weightlessness, the grapes for the sweetness of life, or as he said, ecstasy, the rainbow around here, the three connected egg and circle shape, the spirals with the crocodile and the tiger, the spirals with the twin children and the blue flower. So each of the spirals is done, the dove of Venus, the sun at the root chakra, the coins with astrological symbols that are here, all these different things. It kind of splits into what those general meanings can be. And so that's what we have there. Then lastly, and I know this is not really supposed to be a book review. One thing I also like about this book by Dukat is there's a lot of information about Lady Harris, who actually drew this deck. There's a lot of information about her in here, which I quite love. But this goes in and it talks about the fool, the spirit of the air, elemental trump of air, the original design that it was supposed to be, and then what it actually ended up being, what the tree of life and the path numbers are on it, the colors, some quotes from the Crowley as well. And then he quotes a lot by Crowley, which is good, as well as letters from Harris to Crowley. But he talks about how, in essence, there are not really 22 trumps. There is only one, which is the fool. And the other trumps live inside of him, which is interesting also. And it kind of goes through more detail. And then it talks about the fool is the Holy Spirit itself, the dove, symbol of the Holy Spirit, the butterfly, symbol of transformation, winged globe, symbol of mercurial air, the Egyptian vulture goddess mouth pour from the Holy Grail in the fool's right hand. Like the Virgin Mary, Mount became impregnated by the spirit of the wind. The whole picture, Crowley tells us, is a glyph of the creative light. So you do get a lot of Crowley in this particular book as well. So, okay, that's a lot of book talk. So I'm gonna just kind of step back from the books a bit, because there's just clearly there's a lot of information in these cards, but let's just take a look at them as cards. And I'll take a peek a little bit in the book here and there, but here we have the magician, which is also known as the juggler or the magus. Is it magus or magus? Magus. Crowley calls it the juggler, and I guess that was a term that was he wasn't the first person to use that in terms of the magician card, what we would call the magician card from the Rider-Waite-Smith. And so he's, of course, juggling things. He is also of Mercury. So we have the wings at his feet, or is associated with Mercury, of the wings at his feet. We have the coins, the sword, the wand, and the cup, you know, the elements, the four elements that are there. We have the winged egg again right here. And that's about the fifth element as well. So we have all of the elements, including the winged egg. So we have that going on, you know, with so we see those traditionally. And then there's just lots of other things. There's parchment paper for science. We have the threatening monkey down here for the intuitive nature, instinctive nature. We have, I think that's all the major elemental things that we can see here. We obviously have snakes here. This is supposed to be a rather hermaphroditic character, which I did not realize that the magician card was supposed to be a little bit more male and female, not so strictly one or the other. So here we have the priestess, and of course we have, you know, I think this is beautiful. I love how the dropping of the veil creates a cup imagery there, where you think, even though you don't really see too much waters here, we definitely have that feeling of her actually becoming part of the cup. You know, as you can see the stem of the cup, and this is dropped down, and then she's actually filling the cup there. And the colors are just beautiful. She does have a 7 moon crescents and the moon crown on her head. She actually has a lemon scot or infinity sign around her eyes. And they talk about this as looking at what is eternal. She's got the bow and arrow here that also function as a musical instrument as well. But then we also have flowers and fruit and crystals and things here that really speaks, and it even talks about this in terms of abundance, which you don't often see, at least in the Rider-Waite-Smith. You mostly see that in with the Empress. So I thought that was quite interesting. But in general, this means, you know, this is very quite traditional to the Rider-Waite-Smith. Here we have the Empress here. Which I think is quite lovely, and I really like her in, you know, together with the Emperor, with such red masculine, and then we have the blues and the greens here with the kind of feminine receptive energy here. She's sort of the Mother Nature with this kind of pink-green dress. She has a moon crown on her head. She's got the zodiac signs as her belt here. We do have the moons that are here, just as we have the suns that are in the Emperor card, which I quite love. She has bees on her dress, which is, you know, diligence and fertility. Her hand is open and receptive, almost in a you know, meditative posture that's very open there. I love that. Her scepter is a lotus, which I adore. I just really like this card. She's got a pelican here who is going to pierce its breast to feed its young. Motherly love. We have the double eagle here with the moon behind the heads, whereas the double eagle in this one has the sun behind the head. So I think it's beautiful. It's a beautiful Empress card, and it matches and goes so well, I think, with the Emperor here. And so the Emperor is very reds and yellows and sun energy and masculine energy. You know, the way his leg is crossed has to do with the masculine energy and the symbol for sulfur. We've got the scepter with the ram's head, because of course this is associated with Aries. We have the two suns here. We have the lamb here holding a flag of victory. We have golden lilies for power. I mean, it's just the crown. He's got a crown full of diamonds. It's just very much a very Emperor feeling. He's taking responsibility, security, strength of leadership, you know, all these kinds of things that we think of with the Emperor. I just really like these. As soon as I saw these two, I quite liked the pair that these make. Here we have an interesting Hierophant card. know, this is obviously the symbol of faith, and so we do have sort of the high priest, the look of a high priest. He has his face is like a mask, which I thought was interesting, because one of the things that I read talked about that is sort of idea of being rigid in your beliefs. It's not you're closed off with that mask over his face. I quite like that. He has a staff with three rings on it, the union of past, present, and future. He also has the pentagram with the human there, which is quite interesting. And look what we have below him. We have, this is supposed to be Osiris in a large pentagram. And then here we have a woman with a sword and a moon, crescent moon in the middle here. So this is supposed to be the beginning of the age of Horus. So there's all about ages here. There's a lot of talk in Crowley's about ages. I need to read up a little bit more of that. I'm not going to go too much. But I quite like this juxtaposition of what looks to be a very open female image here. With the blues and things, and we have the masculine here, but it's a very closed off look. So there's lots of interesting. We have four cherubim around the corners, and so on and so forth. So this is an interesting card, but you know, even not again, I need to understand a little bit more about the ages and things, but just straight up as a Hierophant, I think that this works quite well, because we definitely have the idea of traditions, and I love the idea of that masked face that can show that there can be rigidity in religious traditions. So I love that. Here we have the Lover's card, which I quite love. They talk about, see, we have these different layers. Like right at the beginning, we have the two. We have the Black King with the gold crown, and the red lion here, which is supposed to be conscious masculine force. Then we have the white queen here with the silver crown and the white eagle, and this is conscious feminine force. And then we have it kind of reversed down here, and we have the black child with the club, which is about the inner unconscious masculine, and then the white child with the roses would be the inner unconscious femininity. And the way that they're holding hands here is a union of opposites, and the children as well is a inner opposites also uniting. So I really like that. I really like this Lover's card, even though, you know, at first glance it's kind of like, okay, what's going on? We have the chalice that's here. We have the whole kind of the priest here in the background instead of a straight up angel, although we do have a cherub here. I like at the top how we have Lilith and Eve showing the dark and light aspects of femininity that we have at the top. So they're bringing that in there. There's just so much going on, but it really makes sense. We have the Dome of Swords making a clear decision, making clear mental decision up at the top. I really like this Lover's card. I really like this Chariot. I know, it's going to be so bad. In some ways, this is very typical in ways that I don't like with the Rider-Waite-Smith chair, because there's no movement. It's just plopped down there. Not very fond of that. We kind of have the blue canopy. It doesn't have the stars on it, but we can see that. But I really love that at least we have the charioteer who looks like he's sitting here and he's in the meditation pose. I quite like that, because it does talk about that the inner strength, that being the point, not really being the physical strength there. We have a crab up here in the helmet, which associates it with Cancer. Even the red chariot wheels, which I remember from the Heindel Tarot, talk again about willpower. But we have the four sphinxes here, with fourfold exchange body parts in light and dark. So you can see there's different body parts here. We've got like people feet and chicken feet and, horse feet and other kinds of feet, but we got, you know, all things kind of things going on. going on here. We also have the light and the dark. And so, but this is about the four elements also being, you know, masculine and feminine elements, so just all kinds of elemental things. And I really like the four. I know tradition is two. I get it. I like it. I use it obviously all the time. But like Tarot of the Old Path has four elemental horses. I really like that because I do love the elements so much. So here we have, now in this deck, eight is what we would consider in Rider-Waite-Smith tradition to be justice, which is called adjustment. The general meaning is the same. It's about clarity and balance and justice and objectivity. It's the same sort of thing. And it, you know, we can see the scales here. She's up on tiptoe, which is quite interesting there because she's actually balanced on the tips of her toes. The coloration of the blue and the green is supposed to have to do with wisdom and contemplation. The ostrich feathers, which we also see in the Heindel Tarot, that has to do with divine justice. We've got circles and things going on with about balancing light and dark. There's just a lot of things going on here. I think it's beautiful. The coloration is beautiful. I think it speaks to justice. We have the sword with the moon crescent pommel, so that the power is instinctual. I really like that inclusion of the moon energy in with justice. I think that's really neat. Very interesting. Here we have the hermit. I quite like this, and I'm not really one for abstract art, but I really like this hermit. You can see him here, flowing, very flowy. He's got the lantern in his hand. He's kind of bent. It says he's kind of bending in on himself inside of going inward. The red cloak is for courage. The white hair is for maturity. We have the tame Cerberus, or the three-headed hound of hell, so that he's integrated the shadow self into himself. I think that's really cool. We have the right here with the world egg with the snake around it. So it's the mystery of creation, it says. I just love it. Again, even just reading it straight up as a regular hermit, I love it. I'm sorry, Isabel's just gruffing. I just think it's wonderful. It's wonderful. I really like this deck. Now, I've never been a huge fan of artwork for Wheel of Fortunes. Very often, they don't do a whole lot for me. I do quite like this. I like the use of color in this deck. Color is so specific here. Of course, in this one, the violet is about divine authority. But this is about new beginnings and happiness, fateful events. It's changes and shifts, just like we would normally see. We've got this, a lot of the same symbology here. We've got the yellow stars, though, which does add a degree of hope to the Wheel of Fortune, which isn't always there. And it talks about the three figures on the wheel being about becoming, being, and passing. The Sphinx with the sword, which sometimes we do see in decks. We have the crocodile heads. We've got the different heads that are going on for different things. All kinds of stuff going on. But again, you know, I would have no issue reading with this, just with my general knowledge that I have now from my, you know, learning with the Rider-Waite-Smith. So I'm really loving it, and I really love the use of color because color is done very specifically. Lady Harris had a very specific palette with the different colors and what they represent and what cards they connect to, what energy they connect to. All of the color is very, very deliberately done, and so everything needs to be, you know, that's something to be taken into account. talks about the red glowing fire chalice or uterus here. This has been renamed to lust instead of strength. So we have this woman that's kind of draped on the back. She is in ecstasy, passion. This is the love for life. This is supposed to be the seven-headed, you know, kind of lion creature is about, again, our instinctual nature. But there is a definite connection here. There is no needing to come to terms with it. There is that sense of sensuality and vitality. The strength is there, but the strength is because she is fully embracing all of herself. So we can really see what a woman in her, you know, that's embracing both sides is in terms of strength and love of life and passion. That passion is part of femininity, and I think that's quite beautiful. I love this hanged man as well. Again, the coloration is beautiful. There's just so much. Of course, the naked man upside down, we have that. It's interesting that we actually have the nails here, really tying this into the sort of the Christ aspect, which is different. I see Odin for the most part with the hanged man. We have the cross legs as normal. We even have the arms making a triangle, which they talk about with divinity. We do have the ankh above it, the cross above it, but it is also upside down. The greenish background is supposed to have a shimmer of hope, while the blue grid here is about narrow patterns of life and small-minded thinking and needing to get out of the small-minded thinking. I think that's fantastic. The green discs that are at the central points are about having mercy. So it's quite interesting. This is a little bit more of a test of patience. This is a little bit more of a test card than our hangman of just kind of flipping upside down and seeing things different. So it's a little bit different, a little bit of a sacrifice that is quite a test. It's not quite as serene, but it's fascinating. I think it's wonderful. I quite love this death card as well. We do have the black skeleton that is got a scythe, you know, okay, poor scythe. You know, it's the end of something. It's the cutting off of something. The way that his legs are is the shape of a gate. It's a gateway into a new life, which is interesting. The rising bubbles that are going up, we can actually see the ascent into the new life. So that's wonderful. Wilted lotuses, which I don't personally see. We see snakes and scorpions. Of course, this is associated with Scorpio. We have the fish and the snake for death and resurrection. There's all kinds of stuff going on. But I quite love this energy here. So yes, there is an ending. We have death here. But we also have this moving upward and onward into this new life that is quite, you know, quite visible in the card. And I do love that. Here we have what would be the Alchemist or Temperance. This is known as this is named the Art card in this deck. But we have a double-headed person linking the masculine and the feminine together, which is what we see with the Temperance card. But it's, you know, it's quite deliberate here. And I love that we have the dark and the light, you know, crisscrossed and mixed, because it's actually mixed. It's not half and half. It's mixed together. So I think that's wonderful. She has quite a few breasts here. So there is a nurturing aspect. And the same thing with the green dress is about fertility. She's mixing fire and water, uniting opposites. The kettle with the skull and the raven, purification and death as necessary. These are necessary aspects. There's all kinds of stuff going on here. But this is pretty much balancing of powers, harmony, relaxation. It's healing, but it's done in a way in which we have sort of this linking balance of masculine and feminine energies. Beautiful. Here we have the devil card. I love this, the happy goat here. Makes me understand the wild unknown devil goat, who is such a cute little goat, a little bit better. But this is actually Pan, the god of nature. So But he does have his third eye open. Lots of stuff going on. We do have a very clear phallic image. I don't know that I really need to point that out too much, but it's pretty obvious, you know, with the circle here, the kind of the blue receptive feminine energy, the masculine energy going inward. We have the testicle sacs here, which is a life creating forces. But it's interesting because the lotus garland, I'm not always picking out all of the lotus things, I guess over here on top of his head, but then, so we have all that going on, but we can see this back here, the gray material resembling a spider web. So we kind of have the snares that can snag us. It's interesting that the Kabbalah is for the eye. This is about shadows and instinctiveness. This is about the lack of moderation. So there are, you know, there's positive and negatives going on here, which I quite enjoy. But yeah, definitely very phallic going on there. But in terms of meanings, and I like that this book even has a consciousness where it talks about, you know, if you're talking about your consciousness, this is be where you are encountering your shadow. So that's pretty neat. So here we have the Tower, and I know this is, this is definitely going to be a two-parter. Here we have the Tower. Interesting because we have grated windows and doors, and this is to do with that sort of idea of a hardened personality. So that idea of there needing to be an upheaval is more so here. We have this interesting, we have the falling figures, but they're kind of square. We have a dove, though, with a twig up here, which I like. So there is new hope that's going on. The black background is all about destruction and chaos. It's interesting because the Kabbalah letter for this means mouth. And we do seem to have this big mouth here with, it doesn't really talk about this, but we have, oh, this is the fire-spitting maw of the underworld. So this is a, you know, this destruction is coming from the depths of things. This is Shiva's eye here, but I really do like that the dove is there. This is gorgeous. Look at the star, Gwilfin. So we have this beautiful blue figure. Again, blue being that sort of receptive colors here. The very light violet color, it says, is for cosmic intelligence. We have this beautiful star. I just think this is gorgeous. Look at the little star here that's more almost on top of the earth here, which is talks about earthly love. This is the spiritual and the earthly light that we have here and love. We have roses for fertility. We have butterflies for renewal. We have crystals going on here for protection and healing power. You know, I've been really into crystals lately and learning all about them. So I love seeing that show up there. So, I mean, I just think it's a gorgeous card. Not my favorite ever moon card, just in terms of sheer beauty. I love moon cards. But what's interesting is when I was reading is that in this deck, the High Priestess is much more actually speaking of the moon and the moon, which I've always felt. I mean, to me, it's always kind of like, okay, the High Priestess and the moon card, we've got very similar things going on here. But it's interesting because they really do talk about the High Priestess being that moon energy, whereas the moon itself is, the moon card itself is more of that shadowed aspect of it. So, you know, the general meaning they have here is the fear of the threshold before an important step, kind of threatening dark premonitions, these kinds of things. We have the two black watchtowers. It's a gateway of fear. The path between the two is the path to wholeness, and we can see the path going off here. And in the background, we do have the Sky Blue Mountains, which are Nut's thighs, which I love. The crescent moon, though, is facing downwards instead of upwards, which does show, again, the more sinister aspect of the moon energy, or the darker aspect. So I do think that's quite interesting, and that's something that I will definitely be working with. That does resonate with me, what I read about the High Priestess sort of being that moon, true moon in light energy, and the moon card being more the moon in shadowed energy. And so that's something I will definitely be spending some more time with, because it resonates with me. Then we have the sun here, and of course this is pretty similar. We have cherubs here. At least they're not too horrible. They have butterfly wings, and they're really not cherubs. It says they're twin children. Lightness and joy. Of course, I would prefer to have non-little children in mind. That's just how I am. But we have the green mountain, a paradise. We have the red wall. You know, it's the sun card. It's radiant. There's a sun rose that's blooming in the middle, the union of the masculine sun and the feminine principle of the rose. There's a rose crossed at the children's feet. It's just, everything is wonderful. It's happiness, the sunny side of life, new birth, high spirits, you know, all those kinds of wonderful things. And then for 20, they have changed judgment to Aeon, the Aeon. And I quite like this because, you know, the judgment card for me has never been one of the ones that I've set easy with, because it is very much steeped in more the Christian religion, the idea of going to the throne of judgment and having your good deeds and your bad deeds laid at your feet, and whether you're going to get crosses or punishment, you know, crowns or punishment, you know, all that kind of Christian ideology, where this has a much more pagan feel to it. We have the blue body, female body arched in the form of a uterus right back here. It's hard to tell, but this is actually a female form here, right around here. So this is actually Nut, who swallows the sun in the evening and gives birth to it anew in the morning. I mean, how beautiful is that? We have a winged fireball down here, which is Hadit, the goddess of heaven's mate. You know, there's a sense, this is about the union of Nut and Hadit. So it's the new age that's going to be coming in. And we have Horus coming in. Again, we're talking more about the new age that I need to learn a little bit more about. But in the end, you know, right away you can just see that sort of giving birth to the new sun. I love that. That idea of swallowing the sun in the evening and giving birth to it again in the morning. So we just have that sense of transformation and hope and spiritual development that I think is wonderful. And then to wrap up this, I think I'm going to end this first part here with the final of the major arcana, and I promise I will try to go faster. A lot of these are pip cards, so it's going to be easier to go faster in the minors. But here is an absolutely gorgeous, again, never been a huge fan of the illustrations of world cards. I actually think this is beautiful. I like the coloration. We have the virginal dancing goddess here, joy of life. We have the snake here going on, life and death. This is supposed to be about. We do have the shining eye here of perception. There's just all kinds of stuff. All kinds of things going on here. But I do think it is quite, even the sketching that we have going on. We have four water-spitting cherubims for the liveliness of creation. There's just a lot of things going on. It's a completion, the joy of living. She's dancing. There's much more joy to me and movement and feeling in this card than typical world cards. I've, again, never been hugely a fan of world card art, and I quite love this. So There we have the major arcana of the Thoth and or Toth deck. I'm not a huge fan of the imagery of the Fool card. I get all the symbolism. Everything's there. It's not like I can't read with it. It's, you know, it works. But in terms of, you know, it's not my favorite. It doesn't feel like as much like the Fool. Everything else, like, I just think this is the major. I love the mask on the Hierophant. I love all of this going on in the Lovers. I really do love this. I love the use of color. I love that we have the confined thinking here that we're trying to break out of. I love the Death card. I love the movement forward and upwards. We have both Death and the movement. We don't have to pick it out of a little sun over here. I like the smiling goat. It's gorgeous. Not my favorite, but again, I like the energies of understanding that there are actually two moon energies we're working with, not trying to decide whether the moon is particularly what we're trying to get at. So, very beautiful. This is my least favorite image of the deck, of the major arcana, but yeah, I'm thrilled with this deck.